Have you been wondering about the daily work routine of the president?
Shower, pray, maybe take some minutes to read the Quran, and then check his to-do list and work on them. Reservoir visitors or investors and talk to his cabinet members. I think that is what he does.
For someone who starts his day as early as 7:45 in the morning, is probably the busiest man in the country. In order to bring the presidency closer to the people, the Office of the President, in collaboration with GRDS, presents The President's Diary, a monthly TV program that highlights the President's official engagements in pursuit of the National Development Plan.
Hello, viewers, and welcome to another exciting edition of The President's Diary. This is a special edition marking the end of year 2018. And coming up in this special edition, we'll take you through some of the major development activities registered under the Barrow administration in the year 2018.
Also coming up, we had a special one-on-one interview with the Director of Press and Public Relations, Madam Ami Bojang Sisoho, where she talks about the strategies that her office is using to close the communication gap between the presidency and the public. We also had a special interview with His Excellency President Adama Barrow.
For these and many more, please stay tuned. My name is Mfali Fadera and my co-presenter is Zainab Fall. To begin this edition, let's join Zainab Fall for a rundown of the major activities that took place in the past year.
It is the end of year 2018, and as we set to witness the beginning of a prosperous new year, let us refresh our minds and look back on highlights of some of the major events of the past couple of months that President Adama Barrow has been engaged in. The early months of 2018, barely a year and a half into the presidency of His Excellency President Adama Barrow, the Gambia has witnessed some major activities aimed at strengthening legal institutions as well as fostering peace and reconciliation in the country. In July, President Adama Barrow, with a high-power delegation, toured the length and breadth of the country as constitutionally mandated of him. During the nationwide tour, President Barrow keenly listened to the concerns of the electorates, and he delivered some messages of hope, peace, and announced some major infrastructural developments that are currently being executed. In a bid to foster transparency and bring the presidency closer to the people, as well as effectively communicate government programs and policies, President Adama Barrow in September met the media fraternity both within and outside the country during his biannual Meet the Press. As you may recall, President Adama Barrow successfully garnered global support of 1.6 billion euros for the implementation of his national development plan in a summit held at the EU headquarters in Brussels, May this year. President Barrow, in early September 2018, took part in the Forum on China-Africa Cooperation, FOCAC, where he signed four major corporations that will see remarkable improvements in the country's economic and infrastructural development. In the same September, President Barrow attended the 62nd edition of the UN General Assembly, an annual global meeting of world leaders where solutions are provided for the numerous challenges the world is faced with. President Adama Barrow's address touched on the need for global peace, with a particular focus on the plight of the Rohingya Muslims. Still on some of the key highlights of the previous episodes, let's take a look at the historic visit of their Royal Highnesses, the Prince of Wales and the Duchess of Cornwall, to the Gambia in celebration of the country's return to the Commonwealth. The same month has witnessed the launching of the most anticipated Truth, Reconciliation and Reparations Commission that seeks to uncover the truth about atrocities committed in the former regime. Viewers, let's now shift our attention to the groundbreaking event that took place on the 15th of this month in the URR, which saw the laying of the foundation stone of a 50-kilometer road and four bridges. Thousands of people came out to show support and appreciation to President Barrow for what many describe as a dream come true. Myself and the OP communication team was at the event, and Mr. Mfali Fadera, the senior communication officer, was as well there. Mfali, can you tell us how significant this project is to the lives and the livelihoods of people in the region?
Thank you very much, Zainab. That's a very important question. But first of all, before I delve into the significance of these development projects for the people of Upper River Region, I think it is important to highlight that this is the first major infrastructural development project of the Barrow administration. These projects came hard on the heels of major institutional reforms and empowerment, and also the strengthening of our transitional justice mechanism. We've seen the establishment of a Constitutional Review Commission. We've also seen the establishment of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, as well as the kicking into motion of the National Human Rights Commission, among a host of institutions. Like I pointed out earlier, the significance of these projects for the people of Upper River Region cannot be overemphasized. The road, the 50 kilometer road and the four bridges will help to boost regional commerce. It is a regional hub for commerce and trade, linking the urban Gambia and the provincial Gambia, as well as that part of the country with our neighboring countries. These roads and these bridges will also make it easy for people to access social services. It will make it easy for people to move from one point to another in accessing health facilities, in accessing education facilities, among a host of others. The project is funded by the Chinese government to the tune of over $80 million. Zainab, it is also important to point out that this project is funded through a grant from the friendly people and government of the People's Republic of China, which is one of the friendly countries of the Gambia, which also reminds me of the rebranding and the reimagining of the Gambia's image in the eyes of the world in the Global Committee of Nations. Under the leadership of President Adama Barrow, the country is regaining its respect and it is fostering meaningful relations and meaningful ties with partner countries that mean well for the Gambian people. So this is a government that is serious about development, as the President pointed out in his speech, which we are going to highlight later on. And it also signals the seriousness that the President Barrow administration takes infrastructural development, taking into account its importance to the well-being and welfare of all Gambians.
Without doubt, this project marks a significant milestone in the development of the Upper River Region, URR, and the entire country. Growing up in URR and living here for the most part, I am a living witness to the many hours of waiting one has to encounter routinely to secure transportation from one end of the region to another, simply because of the bad roads condition. Always, it is a matter of luck to secure transportation on time, which becomes too unbearable, particularly during the instances. When completed, the project will provide vital access to and connectivity for the communities of Tumanna, Base, Jimara, Kantora, Wuli, as well as in Senegal and beyond. We all know that the River Gambia divides our country distinctively into the north and south banks and separates many communities, such as the URR, causing access by people to each other and to the limited services significantly difficult. A journey from Base to Koina, for example, can take hours. Today, I am happy to announce that all this will become a thing of the past. With the completion of this project, it would be feasible for one to travel the entire distance in URR in about 40 minutes without fatigue or being covered in dust.
Thank you.
have seen how hopeful the people of URR were, starting from the grand welcoming of President Barrow into the region, going all the way into the political rally at Fodekunda. What do you make of that?
Zainab, like I just pointed out, the project means so much to the people of the region. We spoke to some of them during the inauguration in Basse. This is what they have to say.
Ngeto woni Alaye Sirina Badiara namo wuli East de bebe to woni Badiara Kunda lengi wona tare ko nyaadi lengi wo URR oro ho akida 50 years tangare sine o ma me kida kena ni kantora fatodo kille nanga wuli Basse kille Basse Badiara wuli bridge aro Basse fatodo kando wuli bridge Alhamdulillah President Barrow ora tiga are ja gambia ngonda kheringa parce que ngana ay ke tangare sine no gondi URR ga tambebe nya killing khibare nga aro nan kare akoten aswatu kalengi fatodo ro wuli ga na jokime fatodo kando ro ga na jokime wuli ro kando ro joki sanuro wuli jokime aw gambia aparea aw gambia sunya bane gambia sunya kambane aw ngana gri time so alba ke nan go ben any time o do President Barrow o wa tiga no wa nuarni wani tangare sine no gondi URR barga ma kebekida 50 years Force Republic, Second Republic, Omake Mikida Lengue, or like the Tati Republic, what President Barrow Warni, what I'm similar, you are a Menchu, Osua Halengua, Halekumani, Nasa Mani Kama, you are a Menyani, Ka Angelina, no place like home, President Barrow Kenya, among the Karai. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alamin, Gondanda, Pruale interview, Namaji Yang, Sanita Lulokono, Nemasodo, be you are a Vamena independent to be an independence to be. So, nga President Barrow nga jey nga tendu sanita du lokono URR e bata menge bar ni kandola ni wulis jokita nyola sandugo ni bas e fladu jokita nyola ndako doko bandal hanya tara doko danda ni bridge ni silo flo dong akanyanda du leni ni ni bi nga soto bi alhamdulillah ngondande ala naka dan dole bul sabo ni malaka dam lu kairo ti URR ko ndem URR dingole na place jama le mara na place jama le mara URR mu protisanol di nga dogu jamaale ke URR nga lonne URR benu nyame an biya be klab abi tarla dame ngolone alhamdulillah rabbil alamin sewota bak
nin silo nata afelenti kole ya fela talata nsa fa kole ya banda kan nin silo data ay fenje mala nin ka me an ka fa kon si kontano sodu na ko kan mu folo folo nin mo sa sa te bul silo betari kan ba kilni emergency sore se fatano e nyanda fatano damendo yo bar nin silo man sono e to sodu no la wala ya kende silo nyin ka yala ko katan tari bul kontana ku bat man dan dula sorno men adu nimba fana nabilta tuma do as ay sorno ya sorno nyi kan ni yar jani ferio be futale ma si emergency nyi ya soto yani ferio be futale ma o ma baratel be tendi la so ko ya fana sorno bar sa nim salo nin salo kada bañin na e ba jalo ko ya nyim fana betala no lam bulle wala mun talako mot
nin silo nyim bete ada mam bete a baro dam ma ya bete ata banko dingo bele kabrin jam fo koyna man futu koy na ba ndingol be futu ri ma fangola nim bata ko mun telle aji parce que ni di ngobi je nin ti ngoya muta abata di ngose fano wala basi bata bata nyamen ita kalangolon na fango alhamdulillah na yin silo dada ya ma dada te ya dada tel bele banko di ngobe ha sa imbe ala dal la banko la kairo ala ma di la la anin na badi muslimol be awa ala ma silo ni ala ma sono ya la e la lafta menna amma sole ya lo ala ma di la
ah silange foy lo le ye bat sa suto fer yo maka tendroke bara fara maka tendroke suto sa ni sa sa so so ndel ma fara ni ko be na basse jang a tari bara jita wala ve fer yo fana lota tendro manke o fara me ko le ya ko dol ba ni da wato wato han suto ni nat silo ni ngesta mi no talu tan re te jara lo tankan
While in Basse, His Excellency President Adama Barrow also laid the foundation stone of the Gambia College School of Education campus, Basse Extension, a teacher training institute that will ease rural-urban drift in search for better education opportunities.
Since coming to office last year, my government has been engaged in reforming and refocusing the public sector. The education sector, comprising the basic and secondary education subsector and the tertiary and higher education subsector, is one of the key sectors that are given special attention. We recognize that both sectors must operate effectively and efficiently and must meet their policy targets to develop the desired human capital of the country. Encouraged by developments in the education sector, I hope that students' performance and achievement in both national and international examinations, as well as quality of graduates from our education system will be a source of pride for all stakeholders. The sooner we achieve this, the better. Mr. Chairman, for the purpose of providing quality education for all, it is important that the qualified teachers are distributed equally, so that no part of the country is underserved. It is my belief and hope that when the Gambia College Extension Campus becomes functional, the target group of teacher trainees, especially those living in the Central River and the Upper River region, will choose to remain in this area after their training.
Viewers, you are reminded that it is the special edition of the President's Diary. Let's now shift our attention to an exclusive interview that we had with the Director of Press and Public Relations, Madam Ami Bojang Sisoho, where she talks about the strategies that her office is employing to efficiently and effectively communicate the policies and programs of the Barrow administration. And she also talks about the efforts being employed to close the communication gap between the presidency and the public.
In the past, the office of the president was not somewhere we would look forward to hearing information or getting information from. It was very rare. And when we hear, we know what we get. And we are grateful that under President Barrow's administration, he has allowed us as professionals to do what we need to do our work for the country and for his office to be able to share information, because he knows that it is the people who have elected him, and he appreciates that, and he wants to communicate with the people who have elected him, who supports his development agenda and his the partners to this country. Because the Gambia, as we know, a lot of people are focusing now on the Gambia for many good reasons. We have been isolated for too long, and now it is time to open up. And if we are to open up, they want to know whatever the president is doing, and that is very important. When we came into office, the first thing we tried to do is to study and understand the dynamics of how the communication flow is in at the president's office. So since we took a review of the situation, we had an understanding there must be a strategic direction as to how we want to communicate about issues affecting the presidency and to inform people about what is going on here. So since we got that, what we did was to come up with an internal communication strategy that will identify what we want to do, how we want to do it, what we want to use to do it, and this strategy, who are going to be involved in making sure that we implement it in a satisfactory way. And that is why, when we came up with that strategy, we were then able to identify our activity plan out of that. And part of that activity plan is to ensure that whenever the president does something, we have a press release out of it. We also develop further to say, okay, it's not enough to have just the traditional press releases, just like the former heads of states were doing. But we should go beyond that in an era where we find ourselves in an era of social media, in an era of new media, using the website more than often, and also to realize that there are more ways we can communicate. So since we did that, we had our briefings, media briefings, where we invite the media, they come in, they ask questions about what the president is doing and things related to that, and we answer them. And we also have the opportunity to say, okay, whenever we do something here, we share it in the social media. Because let us remember that there are Gambians who are outside the Gambia, and there are non-Gambians outside the Gambia who are using and accessing the social media and new media, including website, to be able to get information about what is happening in the country and at the presidency in particular. So we have developed those platforms, and we are very grateful that young people like you are involved in your with the theme to ensure that we are up to date with what is happening with current. We make sure that we are always updating our website, and we are also updating our platforms. And this is very important for this era we are living in, where you have the digital world. Apart from that, we also make sure that we archive the information in a strategic way. So what we did was to come up with what we call the newsletter, State House newsletter. That State House newsletter, it is something that we use to ensure that we archive a lot of the engagements of the president to ensure that whatever he does is recorded there. And these are the things that we need to be keeping and to ensure that we are also having the right information that anybody who wants to do research relating to his activities, engagements, and things like that, you can get it from the newsletter. And apart from the newsletter, and I'm happy that during this short period, we have been able to come up with biannual newsletter. And we have had our first copy. That was the first one we had, the State House newsletter. We learned from it. We engaged. We tried to make it better. We came up with the second one, which is the second edition of the newsletter. And right now, we have realized that the issue of the third edition is on and is going to be published. Actually, we have already received the dummy. We have reviewed it, and we have sent it back to the publishers so that it can come out and we can share it just like we do. When we share it with the embassies, the international organizations, the government ministries, so that and institutions like the university, GTTI, MDI, all these educational institutions, so that people have access to information, so that it's just not one side of the information, but professionally developed and packaged information that we can all benefit from. We have also tried to do the calendar. Annual calendar that will remind us each month of the year for the past year what has happened as a recollection of events that we can package in a pictorial form and make it a calendar. And we are coming out with more innovations, such as we're going to have the photo diary that will tell stories behind the scenes that the president is doing. And I'm sure when the diary photo diary comes out, a lot of people will be interested in that, because that is the backstage photos we'll be using to tell the humor part of the president and many more other things, initiatives we are taking. And I'm so proud of the team I have, because it has made it possible for us to implement the communication strategy we have developed. And that is why now every month we have the monthly presidential diary that we are having, just like we are discussing with you now, to be able to get an insight into what are some of the things that the president is actually engaging in pictorials, and we'll be able to look at those pictures, put them into context, and discuss them. And I think all these are initiatives. I thank God, I can humbly say that when I thought about this, it was a dream, it was a strategy I had in mind, I developed it, and I needed a team to help me. And I'm so proud of the team I have right now that has helped to make sure that we bring it out to the public for everybody to be aware of it. And there are more initiatives to come, inshallah. But let's keep it to that until everything is set in motion. I'm so happy that all these things we are able to do because we are a team. And if you look at it, we try to even get the president to be able to talk directly to the media. All that is to show that he believes in democracy, he believes in freedom of speech, he believes in freedom of association, he believes in the idea of we as a nation, we can dialogue. And how do we dialogue is when we engage, when we talk to each other. And all that is the principles of the values that we share as a nation. And no matter where you belong, you believe in these values. Whether you accept the content or not, that's a different thing. But you believe in the values, and those values, President Barrow has encouraged us to make sure that we develop them. We develop our programs towards ensuring that we achieve those and maintain those values. And that is why we have the presidential interviews where he talks to the media directly. International media has engaged him during these processes, regional media, our local media, you know. He gives opportunity to people. And I think that is something we have to appreciate as a country, because we have not been exposed to that in the past. So therefore, it's a new thing. I know that democracy is, we are like nurturing it in the Gambia, and people have different perceptions and understanding of it. But as a nation together, I think we are working towards understanding what we mean by democracy and how we execute our democratic rights. And these are very important things that the president values. And I would like to take this opportunity to thank everybody who has made this year a possibility for the president, for the Gambia, and for our small unit in particular. Because I would really want to mention the Chinese embassy for the support they have given us with the cameras we are using and the computers. All this is showing that if we have the right support, we can do even better. And we want to thank everybody who make it possible for us as a nation to realize our goal in the new Gambia. Thank you. Happy New Year to everybody. And I wish you many, many, many more to celebrate in good health and prosperity.
We also had a special interview with His Excellency President Adama Barrow.
It's a great pleasure, and you are most welcome. I'm really pleased to grant this interview to my team, State House. I think this is very, very important. I think this will be a family discussion. The question you ask, that I am always early in the office. And finally, if you are elected or appointed to a position, it's a big responsibility. Because out of 1.8 million people, the Gambian people trusted me to elect me as president. It's a huge responsibility. If it is a huge responsibility, I think as president, you should do what is right always. And you should lead by example. That's why I'm always early in the office. I always respect time. And time is money. Time is very, very important. But it's just because I'm president, that's why I'm early in the office. That have been my life. I established my company in the year 2006. But for that period of 10 years, I used to leave my house latest 6:30 in the morning. I'm always at my office 7 o'clock, so for 10 years. That's the way I used to live before becoming president. So that makes it very easy for me to continue the same. That's why I'm always in the office on time, and I always leave late. Because I chat with one great politician one day. He told me, if you are a president, you always have two things on your table. Things that are very important, and things that are urgent. So obviously, if that things that like that are on your table, you have to attach importance to the office. And leading by example, others will follow. If you look at State House, basically everybody is State House, office, on time. 7:30, people have started arriving. But if the president stays at home until 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock, and you are the one monitoring people, how are you going to do your job? It makes it very, very difficult. Finally, I'm in office because of principle. The principle is I accepted to lead this country. And I was campaigning for good ethics. I was campaigning to make change. Change is not easy. It will take time. But for sure, we will get there. It's a big challenge for you to have that time for your family. Because if you look at the period that you work, you have limited time for your family. But the family understood very well what is the responsibility. It's not like before. It's a bigger responsibility. And it's a bigger challenge. And it's a test for me and my government. Because we campaign. And in that campaign, we promise the Gambian people that things will be different in this country. The family understood that very well. Because finally, if I'm in office since 8 o'clock, I don't finish until 5, sometimes 6 o'clock. Normally, if it's on a Tuesday, if I finish from office like 5:30, I have 30 minutes to prepare and go and do my normal exercise. I start my exercise around 6 o'clock. It takes me 1 hour to finish my exercise till 7 o'clock. The moment I finish from 7 o'clock, take my bath, I wait for the news. As I watch the news, I take my dinner. The moment I finish the news, I have a smaller office in the compound. Go there to handle my files. And I will have a few appointments, 2, 3, 4 appointments. Before I finish, it's 12 o'clock, it's 1 o'clock at night. So there is limited space for my family. But they understood very well the responsibility, the magnitude of the responsibility, and the expectation of the Gambian people. So it's like the family is there to support me so that we can fulfill that promise to the Gambian people. So there is limited time for my family, but I do have that limited time with my family, but they understood definitely what is the responsibility. And what are the challenges? And I need their cooperation and their support to make sure we go extra.
Absolutely.
And we are doing this for Gambia. People voted for us. It's a social contract. And we should do everything possible to make sure we fulfill that. Every president, your only pay is your legacy. And I'm very concerned about my legacy because I know one day I'll be expressed and I want to live in this country. But with a good legacy, you remain president.
Yes, absolutely.
In my leisure time, I do exercise, I do reading. I like reading speeches because I'm always interested in great speeches. I'm a political animal. I have been following politics. I also like watching the news. If I'm on bed, my radio is attached to BBC till in the morning. Because I always want to know what is going around the world. I'm always interested in politics, political events, how political events are unfolding in Africa, in the world. In my that leisure time, I think this will interest you. On Saturdays, my exercise, I play football. I play football with my security team. And I'm their main striker. My opponents always fear me if I'm in the box, especially Captain Fai. They always fear me when I'm in the box. And I've always been their leading goal scorer. And we normally play on Saturdays. You know, you exercise. And at least, you know, have that leisure.
Yeah.
Yes, you know, definitely. I've been a big fan of Arsenal, and I've been a big fan of Arsene Wenger. You know, and football is in my blood. When I was in school, I was also a very good footballer. I was a goalkeeper. You know, when I was playing football, but I've been supporting Arsenal. I can say I cannot know exactly the duration, but for a lifetime, I can say I've been supporting. I'm a natural Arsenal fan. You know, a footballer that I used to like a lot, Ian Wright. Players like Thierry Henry, you know, Patrick Vieira and others, you know, David Beckham. These were players, these were great players.
Yeah.
And the Arsenal players, they did a lot as far as football is concerned.
And I follow also football all over the world. But this is a game that I love, and I used to play it when I was young, when I was in school. You know, so this is a game that I like, and really, I spare time. Even when I was working as a private person, I used to create time to go and watch football. I used to go to video club to go and watch football. But because it was taking too much of my time, I paid for a channel in my office, so I watch football in my office. So obviously football is part of me. That is something that I really follow. Despite I'm president, but I create time to watch football. You know, I have three young kids. Definitely they understand my title as president. But they might not know the responsibility of the president, what it means to be president, but they know. Because sometimes they ask them, what is your father? They say, father is the president of this country. You know about that? They might not know, but the elderly one knows exactly what is the responsibility of president and so forth. And we also always advise him, you have to understand that you are the son of a president. You have to behave yourself. You have to show examples. And you are seeing that it's in him. He's not in the spotlight. He's always concentrated on what he is doing. That means, as I said, your job is focused on your education. A political line, that is not your line. So that's what he is doing exactly. Now, even he told me in his school, this time he scored the highest points. Wow. And they have appointed him as a tutor in that school. They have given him that responsibility. Next month, he will be a tutor in that school.
Wow.
And the moment he told me that, I said, whatever you do, you benefit first before anybody else.
Absolutely.
Concentrate on that. That is your line. Politics, your father's politics, or anything else, don't think about that. Or else it will distract you. But with my kids, the young ones, they are also very busy.
Yeah.
They go to school, they finish school, they go to Dara. So they are also busy, I'm all busy. But sometime during my exercise period, they come and join me. Even yesterday, I did my exercise with them around the state house here with all the exercise houses for 1 hour. You know, and they have their kids, exercise kids and everything. They join me, you know, and we have fun. This is the time I spend with my kids. A lot of people can answer that question because I share food with a lot of people, especially people in the state house and all sort of. I eat with them, you know, sit on the same table with them. So they know. Even some of my cabinet ministers, if you ask them, what is the president's favorite, they will tell you bahal. Because every Friday, we have bahal in the state house. Even when we travel to, even when we are traveling to Basse, at Jarasom, you know, we stop there to have lunch. You know, and he said, today is not bahal. You know, so everybody knows about it. Bahal is my favorite food. Definitely, and it is on Fridays that we cook bahal. When I was in the UK, you know, I told some of my friends that I'll be going home to the Gambia to start business. They are wondering what business I want to do in the Gambia. I told them I have an idea of what I'm doing. There is a market that people are not exploiting. I think I can go to Gambia and exploit that market. That was property management. You know, real estate, you have different sectors. This is property management, managing people's properties. It is a very difficult part of real estate. We are specialized on that. As I was leaving that office, I have more than 2,500 to 3,000 tenants. We're the biggest in this country as far as managing properties is concerned. But when I came, I was looking for an office. People wanted me to hire a big office. Flash office so that everybody will see that the business is big. I said, no, let me start small. Allow me to start small. My business will dictate me. Not you dictating what I'm going to do. I started small, very, very small. My office was like 3 meters by 3.5 meters. I can remember one day, it was on a Saturday, I was embarked on a general clean. My table, everything was outside, so we were clean. As I was cleaning, there was one Sierra Leone he promote businesses and so forth. He came and approached me. Say, I want to see the manager. So you want to see the manager? I said, what do you want to see him? Say, I promote business and also. I said, okay, you can wait for me. When I finished cleaning, pack everything, and I come and sat in the office. I sat at the high table. Mm-hmm. You know, so definitely this man must be the must be the man.
Yeah.
He said, are you the manager? I said, not the manager only, I'm the owner of this business. He said, have you ever traveled out of this country? I said, yes. He said, that's why you are behaving this way.
Yeah.
If you have not traveled, you would not have behaved this way. So he said he promote business and so forth, advertisement and so forth. I tell him, well, me, I have principles. My principle is I will not advertise my business. I will leave my business to advertisement. So my hard work, my honesty, that will advertise. Honestly, for those 10 years, I have never advertised my business. While I was in that office, that small office, it came time my customers have to wait outside. Now that my business is telling me you have to expand. I took 3 times that size. It was not enough. People have to wait again outside. That's the time I bought a property on the highway opposite Islamic Bank. When I opened that business, so interesting. The radio stations, newspapers, banks, they all came. Because now the business is so visible. They told that this is a new business. Tell them we have been here for 10 years. We have bank accounts, we have everything. So you see, your honesty, hard work, the level it can carry. And it has happened. This is just 10 years back. Everybody, if you are serious, you are honest, you will be successful. And that has helped me a lot. It was while doing that business, I was part of the politics. I was part of the UDP. I contested the election 2007. After contesting the election, the deputy party leader was coming to my office for other things, not politics. But as we discussed, he said, you, I think you will be very useful in our executive. But you have ideas. You are clever. And you are honest. Do you think if we invite you, you will join us as executive member? I said, it's left to you. This is how it came. I have never contested for any position as far as the UDP is concerned. They caught me to be part of the executive.
Because of values they see.
Yes. And whilst I was that executive, they trusted me again to give me other responsibilities. Coordinator for URR. Amadou Sane was our treasurer. When Amadou was jailed, our first executive meeting, the party leader himself said, this responsibility of Amadou, I will recommend you entrust it to Adama Barrow to handle our finances. You see, it's because of trust. I didn't contest for the position. I didn't ask for it. But unanimously, they all agreed. And I know they can be my witness. The period I spent as a treasurer, I think the party was very, very organized as far as finance is concerned. Because anything we do, we have to cost it and we stick to that costing. So we are not having problems. So it's because of that today I am president. When our leaders were jailed, everybody turned to me. They are contacting one after the other until it was a chain. Everybody came to the conclusion that we want you to lead this party. Out of trust. That trust today that made the president of the Republic of the Gambia. And finally, believe me, I will never betray this country. Never. I will remain the same Adama Barrow. I will not change. My focus is to develop this country. My focus is for this country to succeed. My focus is to build strong institutions for this country. If you have institutions, strong institutions, the individual doesn't matter again. It's the institution that matters. That means the institution will dictate everybody, including the president. And I believe in the principles of rule of law, respecting laws of the land. That's why I always, any decision, I call my team. What did the law say? This and that. The law says no, it's no. The law says yes, continue that. I think that will always help you. Your consent. If you are doing what is right, your consent is clear. Well, I will appeal to the Gambian people and the government in general to support the National Development Plan for many reasons. Even if you are building a hut, it's good for you to have a plan. That's why when we came, we said no. We cannot move this country forward. Just what the Wolof called Lambat. No. So we have to get a plan. And that plan is our guide. I think today, even if you are from anywhere in this country, everybody knows about the NDP, the National Development Plan. That is in everybody's mind. But nobody will dispute this, that we have a good plan. That's why we are able to sell the plan internationally. And the pledges up to 1.7 billion. But that is not enough. These are just pledges. To make it real, for us to access those pledges, we have to be together. And the government must be aggressive enough to access these pledges. So that these pledges, if we access them, we can implement them within this period of 2018-2021. Well, knowing the electoral cycle, that's why we pick it to 2021. Obviously, 1.7 billion. If we access that money and turn them to projects, the Gambian people will benefit from it. As I said, if the people voted for you, it's a social contract. The social contract is everybody have something in his mind. Everybody have something in his mind. But if you access these monies, it will make a change to every Gambian. Every Gambian will feel the change. As I always said, this cannot continue as they used to be. We have to change, we have to focus, because the world is moving. Gambia can be an exception. I think Gambia have to move with the world. But on principle, I will appeal to everybody. Give the government the support to make sure we access these pledges and Gambia will realize a big change so that everybody will feel that change, so that the change will reflect everybody in this country. Business cannot be as usual. As I said, if you build institutions, they dictate everybody. If you build institutions, the individual is not important, it is an institution that are very, very important. And Gambia, we have to make sure practice that is in the world recognized practices within the framework of the law that must be in this country. It cannot be like the past. Because these institutions, they are very, very weak. That's why everything was focused on the head of state. The spirit was doing everything, but now it's a different thing completely. And we want to work on this, but it will take us time. But with the cooperation of the general public and the Gambian people and the civil servant, I think the civil servant, they have a very important role to play here. As far as you are talking about democracy, the civil servant has a role. We as the politicians, we have our plans, but to execute those plans, civil servant. That is part of their responsibility. So we appeal to the civil servant. They have a big responsibility. That's why we said no. Their salaries are small. We should increase the salaries. Despite things are difficult. But let's squeeze what out of stone to increase their salaries. At least that will be a motivation to the staff, the government, to make sure we whip this country forward. And I think 2019, that will happen. And as I said, I'm not bluffing. 2019 will be a turning point for this country. So the past and now, there should be a big difference.
That's why you said in Uganda.
That's why we said in Gambia. Mm-hmm. That's why we said the dark days are over. Mm-hmm. Dictatorship is over. It's now democracy. And if you say democracy, you have to, the principles of democracy, not just by name. Mm-hmm. But I think that have helped us. And everything that you do, it will not be easy always. It's unfortunate those incidents happen. The incidents happen because we believe in this principle. We believe in democracy. We believe in good practices. That's why we said no. In every democratic society, there is process, due process. You follow the due process. If you follow the due process, it makes the job very easy. That's why we follow the due process. And at the end of the day, everything came back to the cabinet. And when you talk about the cabinet, you're talking about the whole government. So all the decisions that we are taking, it was government decision. It was not Adam Barrow. It's not Secretary General. It's not this man. It's not that. It is the whole government decision. I think we have learned from this. There's a time I spoke to one president. He said, the experience of a president, any incident happened, the way you handle it, the way you follow the process, it will be a learning point for you. That means you have now experienced it. If anything like that happened, you can always handle the situation in that way because you already know the format.
Yes.
I think we have set the pace and we will not relent. It's part of bravery to take those kind of decisions. I think that's very important to everybody. And I think that will build the confidence of everybody and it will build the confidence of government. Finally, as I tell you, I will not betray this country. I will follow due process to the land. And as president also, you have to be tolerant. You have to allow yourself also to be advised. The moment you are advised, it builds your capacity, this will make it. And I think that is paying very well for me. I'm a good listener. And I seek advice. This is the way I do my things. And I will continue to do my things until I finish this office. To become a successful man or successful in anything that you are doing, there is no shortcut. No shortcut at all. The only thing is hard work. You have to be very, very hardworking. And you have to be focused also. I can tell you, when I traveled to the United Kingdom, which was 2002, I met people there 20 years. But what I was able to do in 3 years, they weren't able to do it in 20 years. But when I came there, I have my plan and I was focused on what I want. This is what I want. When I finished that, I was back home. That is very, very important. You have to be focused on what you want to do. And whatever you are doing also, do it with honesty. Finally, whatever you do today, you will get the pay tomorrow. Whether it is good, whether it is bad, but there is no shortcut. But the advice is, the young kids, they have more opportunity than we. Because today, the world is connected. Distant learning is possible now. You understand? The environment also is different for you to educate yourself. I think let them focus on educating themselves. Let them focus on building their capacity because the mantle of leadership will definitely transfer to them one day. And we want a very strong leadership in the future. And that cannot happen if we don't have young, intelligent, strong, honest population. Finally, I'm not bluffing. I just don't want to come and say big things just for the sake of saying it. As I said, before you succeed, you have to work hard. You have worked very hard within these 2 years. That's why now is harvesting period. You work very hard within these 2 years. That's why you are able to secure such a contract for the URR on grant. And the NDP is also coming. The OIC is coming. We are now focused going to Farafin, official opening of that bridge. That bridge has a lot of importance for the Gambia. And we are not stopping there. On the 23rd of February, we are going to launch the ONVG substations in the Gambia. So station in Soma and how to call it and Birkana. And also we are focused on launching Banjul, doing the roads, the drainage and the sewage in Banjul. So these are things that are coming. And we expect also to launch the OIC very soon. And we expect to launch some projects of the NDP, National Development Plan. So we are not bluffing. And we are expecting technical support from the Chinese. And the French have also started rice irrigation. So these are things that are coming. We see them coming. And this is all because of hard work during the period. So the Gambian people, as I tell them, turning point is 2019. They are serious about it, but we want everybody's support. Again, this, I always emphasize this. We want everybody's support. Let's focus on national development. Let's forget about politics. Party politics. Let's forget about party politics. Let's focus on national. If we develop this country, I think all the parties are in the Gambia here. So Gambia is bigger than any other party or any other individual. So I'll appeal to politicians, Gambians, everybody in general. Let us come together as a family, Gambian family, to develop this country. Others can help us. But the ultimate responsibility is with the Gambian people. And I will appeal to everybody to support me and support my government for us to move this country forward. I cannot do it alone. So I need that support. As I said, it's just a family interview. But when I say family, the Gambia is my family. Because I'm the president of this country. It's the people who elected me. They have that trust in me. That's why they elect me as president. So the Gambia, this country, we are all equal in this country. But today, I'm giving the responsibility to the head. If I'm the head of this country, I have a big, big responsibility. But I cannot do it alone. I need everybody's support.
It has been an exciting journey with you since the beginning of this program. We want to take this opportunity to thank the thousands of viewers that follow this program from the Gambia and beyond. You keep us encouraged. You keep us going. Thanks for the amazing feedback. And we promise to bring a lot of exciting content in the year ahead. Zainab.
All right, viewers, that brings us to the end of this very special edition of the President's Diary. Like Amfali rightly mentioned, we hope to bring you more exciting episodes of this program as we go into 2019. It's been an exciting and an amazing journey, and I would like to use this opportunity to thank all our viewers out there who stick to their TV screens whenever it is time for the President's Diary. And like to shed light on what Amfali said, all these are efforts geared towards closing the communication gap between the presidency and the public. Since it is end of year, we are using this opportunity to wish you all a happy and a prosperous 2019. And we hope to see you again next year with more exciting episodes of the President's Diary. Until then, it's a bye from us.